that give you these many, and then there is the values and the value of the vector field itself. Okay. Now, we then quoted a theorem which claimed that completely symmetric spaces, a space that is both homogeneous and isotropic or has a maximum number of killing vectors per completely symmetric, symmetric spaces are essentially weak. That is, they are classified by the value of their energy scale. Now, given a space with a particular positive value of the Ricci scalar, it's easy to produce a space with any other positive value of the Ricci scalar by just changing the overall one. Multiplying the metric and multiplying it by an overall scalar. Okay? So we said that's essentially one space with positive Ricci scalar. That's one space with zero Ricci scalar. And one space with negative Ricci scalar. Essentially three up to scale. There are three symmetric spaces that are unique. Okay? And once we know that they're unique, it's very easy to classify the spaces, and I just remind you to construct this. And I remind you about construction. The guy with zero Ricci scalar is obvious, it's flat space. Okay? Flat space has P into P plus 1 by 2 killing vectors because it has the P into P minus 1 rotations. And it has the translations. It's the point cut here. Okay? The space with positive curvature is the sphere. Okay? And in the previous class, we talked about this for the special case P equals 3, but it's totally general. But this space, x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 plus 1 squared a squared. If I have the sphere, how many killing vectors do we have? How many symmetries in the sphere? How many symmetric directions in the sphere? So all the rotations in p plus 1 dimensions, and that is? P plus 1 into p plus 1 minus 1 by 2. So p plus 1 into p by 2. Okay? So it's completely true in every dimension that the sphere gives you the maximum use. And we talked about ways of parametrizing, coordinate parametrizing the sphere, which we perhaps get back to. Okay, and the space of negative curvature was also easily calculated. Okay, for the space of negative curvature, what we did was to look at the space minus x 0 squared plus x 1 squared plus x 2 squared x v squared. Is equal to minus 6. Okay? And part of this has as a manifold embedded in R1 cog. Okay? And if you remember, we used these equations to derive the metrics of these maximally symmetric spaces. And I'll just quickly do that for you again. In the form that is when these two are simply related. So the form we're going to take is to let x1 and xp parameterize the coordinates on a p-dimensional sphere. A p-1 dimensional sphere of radius r. Okay. So the metric. So let's first do this. So the metric is going to be. So then this tells you that x1. So what it means. So suppose x1 squared plus x2 squared let me use uniform notation. Let me call the x plus 1. So I'll always solve for the first. Here for x plus 1, here for x0. Okay. So suppose in each case x1 squared plus x2 squared plus xp squared is equal to r squared. So we've got, we use polar coordinates in this p minus 1 dimensional space, parameterized by the angles, whatever they happen to be, of a p minus 1 dimensional sphere, and this radius. Then, suppose we look at ds squared, which was plus minus And let me call this also P plus 1. It is to be uniform. It's the negative direction. So plus minus dx P plus 1 squared plus dx 1 squared up to dx P squared. Okay? Then we plug in this part in here. Okay? And what do we get? As we saw last class, we get ds squared is equal to dr squared plus r squared d omega p, p minus 1 squared. When d omega p minus 1 is the metric on a unit p minus 1 dimension. Okay? Remember, symmetry forbids us from having a cross, a dr, the, you know, the angle there. Because there's no vector field that is has the full rotational symmetry in the sphere. Okay? And that you get just dr squared with the coordinate 1 we all argued in gradient, with the factor 1 we argued in gradient, gradient table for the three dimensional case. The argument is general. Okay? So this is the part that comes from this part. But there was also the part that came from here. But this was very simple, because x p plus 1 was simply equal to, so let me here plus x p plus 1 squared. But x p plus 1 was simply equal to, now, so there's an r square here, so we get either a square and then plus minus r square. Minus refers to the sphere. And plus refers to Euclidean this other case, this negative correction case, Euclidean six space. Okay, you see that you get the other side here because you put r square here, and you take it to this side, cancel minus. Okay, so now substituting in, we got the metric that the ds squared is equal to. Now, all we have to do is plug this in here. So we get d, we get r dr, the whole thing, square, by a square minus plus r square. You see, when you differentiate this, you get a factor of 2, but you also get the half of the square, which almost cancel. You get a factor of plus minus up here, but it's squared, so that's. Okay, so the okay. And then plus d r squared. Plus r squared d omega p minus 1 squared. And then we add this up, you get and now there's also plus minus here because this came with a minus. Okay, so we get plus minus r square minus plus r square plus a square into the r square by a square minus plus r square plus r square d r square. And so that is equal to a squared over a square plus minus minus plus r square. R square plus r square d omega p minus 1 square. In the special case that we were particularly interested in, namely p is 3, this d p omega p minus 1 was sine square theta d phi square plus d theta square. Okay, so these were our maximally symmetric spaces, the ones that are less familiar than flat space, of course, the flat space is nothing to say. The metric is the x squared plus the y squared plus the z squared. Okay? Sorry. Now, any questions or comments about this? Okay. So now this is the starting point for our discussion of topology. As we said, we're going to assume that space is completely isotropic in homogeneous. Okay? And then see what that takes us. Now, there are two, with this assumption, there are two natural forms, there are two reasonably natural forms of which triangle.
The full space dimension. One of them was the one we've done before, was ds squared is equal to dt squared minus, let's give it the name of it. Minus a of t squared, and then let's say we take this metric with radius equal to 1. So a of t is the radius of this space. Okay? Times d space 3. This is either the metric of the sphere of mass space or Euclidean empty Euclidean space with radius equal to 1. Okay? There is another quad. Now, by redefining time, there's another form in which it's sometimes convenient to view this. It's the same metric. And that's this one. Is equal to a of eta of t squared. You know, d eta squared minus d x. So what do I do to go between the first and the second form? What I do is to do a coordinate change. Okay? So let's see what coordinate change we need to do. The first and the second guy. You say, suppose I go to a new coordinate, so t is equal to t of t. Okay? How would this metric change? Well, of course, this thing will just become a of t of t. But this guy changes in a slightly more complicated way. It changes as dt by d eta. You know, so the thing behind d eta squared is dt by d eta squared. And in this metric, what we demanded is that the coefficient of this and this is the same thing. So in order to make the variable change, what we have to do is to solve the equation that this is equal to a of this gives us a differential equation which we can solve, you know, to go from one coordinate system to the other. Okay? We'll see in examples. It's easy to go between coordinate systems. These are two different coordinate systems, each of which has their own minutes. Okay? In the first one, t is the proper time. We will very soon see, I'll write down in 10 minutes, the Christoffel symbols in space. And you will very soon see that in this space, lines of constant spatial location, constant position on the sphere or the Euclidean de Sitter space, the flat space, are geodesics in space. Okay? So if you were an observer floating around in your rocket ship, or you were a galaxy floating around in this space, if you started out at constant position x and nothing was bombarding you, there were no forces in you, there were no forces that you cancel, then you would stay there. Okay? So observers, like galaxies in this space, are labeled by constant positions, constant spatial positions. We'll see this soon. Okay? Constant spatial positions in this universe. And then t is simply the proper time, the time measured on a watch, by one of these, by any of these sensors. Okay? So t is a very nice physical interpretation. Eta is not so nice physically. It's sometimes called the conformal time. And the reason for that is that this space here is conformally up to this overall factor. Multiplication of a metric by an overall factor is sometimes called a conformal. So this space up to this overall factor is just dt squared plus the metric of the sphere, or the metric of the flat space, the metric of empty disks, the Euclidean empty disks. That's time and space in direct product. Up to this conformal factor, it's time and space, not product. Yeah,
this, for some purposes, this is also. Okay, so T is the proper time of the flawless. Eta is what's called the conformal time. Both will be useful in many contexts. Yes? So one set of GDs, the D6 we've talked about, they are constant values of space.
Yeah.
Okay? Other sets of GDs we'll have to solve.
Because of this part, theta is
because of this?
Yeah.
The eta square. You see, there is this A of eta outside here. So we can, the GD6 of this space are not the same as the GD6 of the space without the eta. Okay? So one should, it doesn't simplify things too much. Fine. Now, what we're going to do is to try to solve Einstein's equations. So, to determine, so we almost completely got the form of the metric, but not quite. Please.
So since eta is not a prime parameter, the equation of the geodesic would change. Would it need not be the final equation?
You see, for the particular geodesics, space equals constant. We continue to be a geodesic. Yeah. It's true that, you see, just being at a constant location in space will continue to solve the equations. Then how you parameterize, how you move along the geodesic, it's true that the time along the geodesic is not eta. So the lambda of the geodesic will be the that function of eta that we just wrote down in this differential equation. But just the geometrical path in space, which is always sitting at space equals constant, you know, that continues to be. Yes?
This having AT there does not change anything. If that AT is not there, does DT square minus DT space do that?
Right. In general, that will not solve any equations of motion. You see, suppose we've set no matter, for instance, and we took this thing to be the sphere. Then that will not solve Einstein's equation. Because the sphere has curvature. So you will get something on the left-hand side of Einstein's equations, but there will be nothing on the right-hand side of Einstein's. So you see, what we are doing at the moment, by making this assumption of symmetry, after having made the assumption of symmetry, we've written down the most general form of the metric. You're not allowed to do more than that. You're always allowed to impose a symmetry. Because, well, okay, no, not always. You're usually allowed to impose a symmetry. I think always. You're always allowed to impose a symmetry because, you know, if you've got some solutions instead of equations that have a symmetry, then there are, you've got some set of equations that allow for a symmetry. Then there's always, is there always, at least I should qualify, I'm not sure if it's always true. It's usually true that there are solutions with that symmetry. You may find that there are no solutions, in which case you've done something. Perhaps it's impossible. I think it's always true. I would have to think about it. But I think it's always true that there's a solution to this. Okay? But what I mean is that by making an ansatz that is dictated by enforcing a certain symmetry, you are not killing solvability of equations. But if you just make some random ansatz for the metric, that may not be what the right solution will be. It may not solve the equations of motion. Okay? So all we have done is to write down the most general metric consistent with the symmetry ansatz that we've got. And we're not allowed to make any, we can't say, well, wouldn't be nice if A of T was sine T. You could say that, but with reasonable matter on the right-hand side, it will not be sine T. I think that's the dynamics. It's how the universe will expand as a response to the matter. It's not the odds.
But
I
said GTD space.
This was a consequence of symmetry.
In space, it was a consequence like DT.
Even there, it's a consequence of symmetry. You see, because what we want is a metric that has all these killing vectors in it. Has all the P into P plus 1 in the case of three dimensions, all the 10 killing symmetries of the spatial metric. And once again, there is no, let's say on a three sphere. There is no vector field in the three sphere. that has all the rotational invariants of the station. So suppose you had a dt d space term. As far as the three sphere was concerned, that would be a vector field. So you have one index. Okay? And if you wanted it to be enjoy all the symmetries of the three sphere, then it would have to be a vector field that was rotationally invariant and the full SO4 symmetry of the three sphere. But there's no such thing. Okay? There's a similar theorem for Euclidean decision space. Certainly, it's an obvious theorem for flat space. Okay, because you would have to have a vector field, that a vector field some arrow, you rotate it, it rotates. Is that clear? So the fact that there is no vector field in any of these spaces that enjoys the full rotational symmetry, the full Killing symmetry of these spaces, ensures that if not consistent with these Killing symmetries, there is no DT in the space term. Okay? So that is not an assumption. It follows from our ansatz of symmetry, from our demand of symmetry. Okay? But now, you might have thought there were two functions of time. There's one behind this and one behind this. But one of them can be controlled by quantity.
So is it all dt dx terms are essentially the dot products of the vector?
That's right. So that's right. Suppose we've got some coordinates theta alpha on our station. Okay? So the dt dt alpha term is of the form dt d theta alpha. And some A alpha, which would be a function of time, and now as far as the spatial coordinates are concerned, this is a one form. In space. One form vector field sensing raise and lower, the spatial metric. So the question is that if this space had all the Killing symmetries of your underlying spatial manifold, then this one form here had to be invariant under the symmetry generated by those Killing vectors. But there's no such one. There's no such one form field. You know, A alpha, theta alpha, there's nothing.
So there are some spaces
there. When there exists invariant one form fields.
Circles.
Yes, yeah, exactly. So a circle would be is a circle itself. Something. But A, right. So I should say for P greater than or equal to. So this space being two sphere of mine.
There are none.
It's something I'm familiar with in the case of two sphere, from the fact that there are no vector spherical harmonics with any equals. Scalar spherical harmonics start at n equals 0. Which at some point in some course you study vector spherical harmonics. And you might remember that Jackson, you study Jackson. Full of vector spherical harmonics. Horrible stuff. But anyway, it starts at n equals 1. L tells you how it rotates. Vector spherical harmonics only appear in multiples. It's a very easy thing to do. It's easy to understand both intuitively and mathematically. Okay, but it's true. Okay? Okay, great. So now we've got the form of the metric of our space. Okay? We've not completely.
Does it imply
that
matter fields have similar
symmetry? Yes, it would imply that stress tensor should have related properties. Because otherwise it wouldn't be consistent with Einstein's equations. Yes?
But the matter fields themselves.
Matter fields, what do you mean?
As in the distribution of matter is different at
no, I mean...
giving the same stress tensor.
Okay, as long as Einstein's equations only see the stress tensor.
So,
you know, if you've got red stuff here and blue stuff here, but they have the same energy momentum tensor, Einstein's equation works.
But then evolution can break the symmetry.
No, not. Oh, you mean, but this affects the equations of motion of the matter.
Yeah. And that breaks the symmetry.
That would break, right. So anything that either Einstein's equation see, or the equations of motion of the matter will see, would have to respect this. Will be different. Okay, but if you've got red dust here and blue dust here, both of all, you know, red galaxies on one side, blue galaxies on the other side. Whatever that means. Yeah, with the same mass. Yeah. Anything that is blind that is not seen in the equations. Yeah. Okay. Fine. Okay, so now let's move on. We've almost completely determined the form of our metric, which is right, because we still need to know what this A of T or A of tau function is. So now let's start writing down how we're going to determine that. That has to be determined by solving that set of equations. Okay, so we take this form, so as usual, we take this form of the metric and we start computing, you know, all the things about, all the things one should compute when one has a metric. We start computing just all the things. Okay? And according to the policy we decided on a few classes ago, we're not going to actually compute Christoffel symbols or curvatures in class. Okay? So I'm just going to go with the values. Okay, now for this purpose I'm using this form. Maybe I have to choose one, I'm choosing this one. Not because lambda I'm choosing. Actually, the equations are comparably complicated in that form. Weinberg works with this form. Which is an irritating thing because it makes it harder to compare, you know, formulas. But anyway, we're working with this form of the metric. And we get, I'm just going backwards. I'll derive one of these just so that we see what's happening. Lambda reaches up. And we use ij for space. And let's put derivative will be denoted by dot because of the time. Muse. everything was on demo, sorry. Mu.
And this is
these are lambda digits on the 1, 2, 3.
No, I'm using our conventions, which means Greek is all. That's why I was first writing lambda digits. Okay, fine.
Okay, now we want to look at. We claim that xi equals constant, and x0 is equal to some function x0 of tau. We're not specifying what this function is, but obviously that is. Just get proper time. Is the solution to this equation. So really it's this part.
Xi equals constant solve the equation.
So now, if xi equals constant as a solve the equation, then d2 by d tau square of xi should be 0. Okay? So that means that this right hand side should be 0 when we've got an I in theta. But self-consistently, the only thing on the right hand side is dx0 by d tau, because dxi by d tau is 0. So that's a question of whether gamma I 0 0 vanishes or not. But gamma I 0 0 does vanish. Alright? So from the fact that gamma I 0 0 vanishes, it's true that constant spatial locations are duly sixth distribution. Okay? So the galaxies in this cosmology will be a constant, labeled by constant locations in space.
Which are the time axis of orthogonal to space will have
this? Time axis of orthogonal to space. No, I don't think that's a waste. You see, it was very important here. Is this true? Let's write up the formula for G00i. I mean, all we need is the gamma 00i, which is that's what we need. So let's check. So let's look. So gamma 00i is equal to GI mu by 2 times gamma 0 G 0 I 0 mu. Minus G 0 0 I mu. What am I saying? Sorry. G 0 mu 0. So now suppose we are in a basis in which there's nothing off the edge. So mu is a purely spatial index. So let's say that this guy vanishes. But this guy didn't vanish. If G0, 0 depends on where you are in space, then this guy is not vanishing. And it won't be true. You see, an easy way to say it. Yeah, exactly. The Schwarzschild metric. Exactly. Has this property that times of quantum space. But yet, if you just put things in particular quantum space, it's not a solution. False. Because of the potential. Yes. So, okay. So much for these Christoffel things. Now the Christoffel triple can be used to compute curvature components of interest. And by the way, okay, so now this was, the thing we did was a check that gamma I is equal to 0 actually vanishes in this case. Okay, fine. So now it can be used to compute the curvature components. I'm going to write down what you need. Okay. So you get R0 is 0 is equal to 3 by 8.
A dot square minus A square. Sorry, minus A. A dot double. Okay. Now, you see, what can you say with R0? Usually, what can you say about it? The answer is it must be zero. Yeah, you would have to work through thinking that way, but it follows from symmetry. You see, if a metric has a certain symmetry, then the curvatures will continue to have that symmetry. Okay? Now, R0i is a vector field under purely spatial notations. It should respect all these Killing symmetries of that. So what remains is Rij. Rij, of course, is not zero. Now, there are two contributions from Rij. There's the part that you get with only the gamma ij case. And there's the part that comes from including the zero components as well. Okay. Now, the part that came from gamma ijk is we already know. Okay, let's remember. We had written down some time ago that R alpha beta gamma delta was equal to G alpha gamma G beta delta minus G alpha delta G beta gamma
A squared, and that A squared is part of that, or the other stuff.
Okay, so when you work all that out, okay, now I'm going to follow lateral relations and first work out things for the case of positive curve. First work out things for the case of the sphere, and then we finally write down all answers. And the zero vectors. So for the case of positive curvature, you get Rij is equal to 2a squared by 4. Okay? And then in relation you get plus a naught squared plus a. Times the fact that Rij has to be proportional to delta Ij, that again was basically a consequence of symmetry. You know, there's no other symmetric tensor other than the metric tensors. Okay? And then this is the coefficient of that. Okay. So this is the value of Rij. And this was the value of R00. Okay? Now, with these in hand, we're all set to write down Einstein's equations. Okay, but before we start writing down Einstein's equations, we need to know what comes on the right-hand side of Einstein's equations. What is the matter? What is the matter that fills the universe? Now, of course, you know, the matter that fills the universe is very complicated stuff. It's made up of the quantum field theory that makes up standard model of quantum physics, made up of quarks and electrons and neutrons and protons and, you know, all that stuff. Okay? And the actual thing on the right-hand side is comes from the very complicated actual quantum state of stuff. So, you know, you are actually sit and solve that, you're dead. Okay? And it won't have the right symmetry. But what we're trying to do is take a coarse grain point of view. And there is this wonderful thing about matter. That about, you know, almost about this precedence of any reasonable form of matter that comes from quantum field theory, that long enough distances, it can be, the stress tensor can be approximated by that of a fluid. Okay? So, we're just going to have a 5-minute tutorial on fluids. Okay. So, what is a fluid? So a fluid is made up of some collection of stuff. Okay? The great thing about a fluid is that the important thing about a fluid is that it is assumed locally to be in some sort of thermal equilibrium. Okay? So suppose you've got some collection of stuff. You look at any little local region of that stuff. That little local region is assumed to be in thermal equilibrium. And the parameters of this thermal equilibrium are functions of space and time. So in the simplest case that we'll be dealing with, thermal equilibrium, well, let's look at, for instance, a gas of photons. Okay? These photons may be interacting with each other, interactions induced by integrating out the photons. They interact with, and they, these through these interactions, they dominate. Now, what are the parameters of thermal equilibrium for a gas of photons? For a gas of photons, the parameters of thermal equilibrium are simply the temperature of the gas of photons. Okay. There's no particle number. Particle number is not conserved for it. It would be for gas and electrons. In which case, the parameters of thermal equilibrium would be temperature and chemical potential dual to that particle. But in this case, it's just temperature. Now, in general, for a fluid, you could be in thermal equilibrium, but in some frame. So this thermal equilibrium stuff could move. And how fast you're moving could be different. Just like the temperature of your stuff can be different. How fast you're moving can be different at different conditions. So in addition to the parameters of thermal equilibrium, there's also a velocity field. Those are the variables of fluid dynamics. The variables of fluid dynamics are the temperature as a function of
x and t. Chemical potentials, for instance, is a function of x and t. And then also the velocity field of this equilibrium stuff is a function. And for all the other parameters of thermal equilibrium, the many kinds of charges that we make, for instance, we make potentials. Okay? These are the variables of fluid dynamics. Now, what you've got is this stuff that is approximately in thermal equilibrium. Other stuff here that's also approximately in thermal equilibrium. But the parameters are different here. Yeah, the temperature is different here. Now, you see, if equilibration happens because things collide with each other on some sort of length scale, called the length scale of the mean free path. Okay? If the temperature, the fractional change of the temperature is substantial on the length scale of one mean free path, then it's basically meaningless to talk about equilibration. Because then the very notion of the temperature is fuzzy. So what you require for this description to make sense is that the fractional change of the temperature on the length scale of a mean free path is small. Okay? So, you require, for instance, that dT by dx divided by dx, this fractional change, into LMF3 is much, much the same. LMFB is the mean free path. This is the condition for fluid dynamics to be a good description of what we discussed. When this condition is satisfied, it's reasonable to consider the parameters of equilibration as being the basic dynamical fields. Okay? This is a huge simplification of dynamics. Because instead of thinking of all the complicated degrees of freedom of microscopic physics, we need only worry about a temperature and a chemical potential and velocity.
The mean free path will be a function of temperature.
So whether this is true or not will depend on the particular configuration you look at. Okay? Fine. But when this condition is satisfied,
can you explain this condition?
Where does it come from? Well, okay. It comes from the fact that what you're trying to think of is stuff equilibrated. But you know, equilibration happens because of collisions that happen over a length scale. If you're equilibrated, you're equilibrated at a given temperature. If on the length scale of a mean free path, the temperature is not well defined, meaning changes substantially in fractional units, you're clearly not equilibrated. So the whole thing is not self-consistent. Again, so fluid dynamics actually, okay, so these are variables. The equations of fluid dynamics are simply the statement of the conservation of the stress tensor and other charges due to these chemical conditions. Okay, let's do some counting. How many variables do we have? The number of variables in the game are temperature. Let's look at the simplest case of four transistors. This is nothing. Temperature and chemical potential. So in four dimensions, there are four variables. The three variables for the velocity and one for the temperature. How many equations is the conservation of the stress tensor? Four. Same number of equations as temperatures. Okay? However, you know, the equation of the conservation of the stress tensor is an equation for the stress tensor. The variables are the temperature and velocities. So this is not a dynamical system unless you have a way of expressing the stress tensor in terms of temperature sciences. So, the key ingredient in fluid dynamics is what's called constitutive function that expresses the stress tensor as a function of thermodynamic parameters, thermodynamic fields. Now, we need to understand these constitutive relations in order to make progress with cosmology. So, let's see. So, what we want to do is to express the stress tensor as a function of these thermodynamic fields. So, let's first, you see,
inbuilt in the notion of, in the very notion of fluid dynamics, is the idea that things are locally coordinated. That is, so things are very small compared to, are very slowly compared to some of the landscape. So, it's sufficient, in fact it's stupid to ask for more, to specify this stress tensor as a function of all, with, all variables in, a del- in an expansion in derivatives. And the first term that you want to specify is the term with zero. Okay? So the term with zero derivatives, now the term with zero derivatives is very easy to specify. Because if the term has no, no derivatives, then it's the same for an equilibrium fluid. You can't tell the difference between whether the fluid is an equilibrium or not. So the first thing that we do is to ask, what does this, what does the stress tensor look like in equilibrium? Okay? So, team mu, well, there are, if there are no derivatives, you can have u mu or u nu, and you can have g mu. That's good. Done. The only things that have the right tensor structure. And let's find the right names for the coefficients. Okay, and now let's get our sign conventions. Now sign conventions, G00 is positive, and GIJ is negative. So let's look at the IJ components of these. I mean, the components that are orthogonal to, that are orthogonal. So I'm gonna write something down and then you, that will be. So I'm claiming that at zero ordinary derivatives, the stress tensor of a fluid must take the form, T mu nu is equal to epsilon times u mu. Plus minus p that this is four stars. Firstly, that it has to be proportional to this and this. That's four stars. Because there's nothing else with the right index. What? That has two derivatives. We're looking at the terms with zero derivatives. Okay? Yeah, there could be forms later on. Okay. Now, this P is the energy density of the field. And P is the pressure. These are just names. Okay? But they're important names because they connected due to the equation of thermodynamics. Now, why is this the case? Well, let's take the special case. Okay? In which U was, we're in flat space. U was 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. Everything was empty. Fluids at rest. Okay? Then how would the stress tensor? The stress tensor will take the form. In the 0, 0 component, epsilon plus p minus p. So epsilon. And the 1, 1 component, this would be p. Which is how we want the stress tensor to go, right? Pressure is the, is that force, that the II component of stress tensor, and the 0, 0 component. And now you can go to any, for a fluid in equilibrium, you can go to any other, this is always true, you always make the boost to go to the coordinate system in which we have 1, 0, 0, 0. So in this case. Okay? So, this is what the stress tensor of a fluid is. where epsilon is the energy density and P is the pressure. Now, have we gained anything by writing in this form? Yes, we have. We'll gain the fact that we, that instead of, you know, naively you might think there are two functions of temperature. That's why symmetry analysis we put here. But there aren't, because if, once, for a fluid, once you know epsilon, you also know P from the equation state. Okay? Suppose you have the free energy as a function of temperature. From the free energy, you could derive both the energy density as well as the pressure. Pressure is in fact minus the free energy. And the energy density is the appropriate derivative. These are not independent things. Okay? So from thermodynamics, in the particular case, for instance, of a gas, where there's only one observed charge, there's only one unknown function of temperature, which is, for instance, the pressure. Or instead of the temperature, you could treat the energy density as well. And that the pressure is determined as some function of that, of the energy density, from the equation of state. You know, the particular fluid has some equation of state. You need to know that equation of state. And that equation of state, which is just determined by the intrinsic properties of that fluid, not where you put the fluid, and so on, determines the pressure as a function of temperature. Okay? So in the particular case of a photon gas, there's only one conserved charge. There is basically, you know, just a single, there's just one single here, length, namely that the temperature is a function of space or the energy density is a function of space. Okay. Now, higher orders in the derivative extension introduce more terms, the stress terms. But it turns out that, and as we will see later on, that all these terms are utterly negligible in cosmological. Also, yeah, okay, these terms basically are utterly negligible for most of the cosmology. Okay, so we're going to forget about them. We just write this form of these stress tensor down here. And forget about all the other terms. This stress tensor is called the stress tensor for perfect motion. Okay, and then what are the equations of motion of fluid dynamics? The equations of motion are simply the statement of the conservation of the stress tensor. Okay. Now,
excuse me, sir. So if P is changing at every point, then how do you assume it to be isotropic?
So it will have to have the P itself will have to have the symmetry
at each point.
Meaning, you see, P is a function of both time and space. It will have to have the same value. Suppose we are on a string at every x, but it will be allowed to be a function of time. So in our situation, P will be P of, that's the only way it could have this isotropy. Okay? That will ensure that the stress tensor has the symmetry of the stress. Is this clear? Okay? Because this is the unique scalar field. The unique scalar field that has the symmetry of the sphere is the constant. So it doesn't depend on anything. Excellent. So now we know up to the equation of state, which we're going to leave unspecified right to the end, because there are many interesting questions about that equation of state, of the effective equation of state that is filling the universe. Up to that question, we know the form of this resonance. Let's say a word about this equation of state. Okay. You see, suppose we had Einstein's equations, and the only matter was effectively the galaxies, then this matter would behave effectively like dust. The galaxies aren't constantly colliding with each other. So there's no pressure. Okay? So just the galaxies, what's sometimes called cold dust, the cold what? Visible matter. Cold visible matter. Okay? So the galaxies and, you know, interstellar hydrogen and so on effectively behaves like dust. And the equation state is these beings. So for those galaxies, you plug in this form of the equation state, of the stress tensor, but with P equals A. On the other hand, as you all know, there's this cosmic microwave background. This gas of photons that's spinning out of space. These photons aren't at rest. They're moving around. You know, if you take a little box, they're constantly going in and out of the walls of this box. So they have pressure. Okay? And we know what the equation of state of a photon is. Can anyone tell what's the equation of state?
Rho by V.
Very good.
V is equal to rho by 3. Actually follows from
E by 3. Follows from scale dependence. The stress of the stress tensor for gas photons must vanish. Because the photons are conformed. If I take the trace of this, I get 1. If I take the trace of this, I get 4. Okay? So E plus P must be 4 times P. Sorry, 4 times P must be E plus P. Therefore, 3 times P must be E. Therefore, P must be E by 3. The trace of the stress tensor for a gas of photons is it vanishes, scale it.
So you can learn from the blackboard you put the numbers.
Yes. You would get from a detailed calculation. You could figure this out on general grounds without doing it. Okay. Great. Fine. So this is one kind of equation state. There's another kind of equation state. Okay? There's a third kind of equation state. Which is of great interest because it looks like it's there in all of this. And that's the equation state for cosmological constant. Let's talk about that.
In the case of photons, is the main key part, right? So, I guess the fluid picture is true.
It's true. So you see. You're asking how long do the photons take?
And there's no mean free path.
There's no mean free path in some. Firstly, in some sense, there always is, right? Because the photons interact with each other through loops of the nucleus. So they're not exactly. But you're right that they interact on very long time scales. So you know, the question that we're asking is if you take some photons here, set them out of equilibrium. How long will they take to be equilibrium? It's true that the time scales would be very long, but we're also talking about very long time scales. Talking about cosmological time scales. It's a good question. How do these two time scales compare? I suspect that, if we were out of this regime, if the mean free path was effectively infinity in this case, then we would have to worry about the other.
You're saying they would never equilibrate.
They would never equilibrate. No, I think it must be that even for the photons, we're in the regime where equilibration happens much faster than cosmological constants.
So, the electrons introduce some
activity. Yeah, they would be interacting for all kinds of reasons. There would be this interstellar dust. The photons would interact with that, and there would be loops of electrons. The main mechanism for equilibration will be through interstellar dust. You see, in a black body, for instance, why do you get such effective equilibrium? Because you keep hitting the walls. That interaction that is essentially the best. So the other stuff will be at some temperature and then it will equilibrate with that. And with the galaxy. There will be various mechanisms for equilibration that will happen faster than cosmological time scales. Even for photons, yes. Okay, but there's one more effective form of matter. That's not really a form of matter. That's just the energy density of the vacuum itself. Okay? But that can be treated like an effective fluid. And it's convenient to do that, so we can use one uniform set of formulas for all possible kinds of matter. That's the cosmological constant. Okay? So let me just go back to a brief discussion of the cost function of conservation. This cost been taught 15 years ago, you might well say, like Landau, you should say in their book, that there's no particular reason to. And there's another particular term in Einstein's equations that looks like a zero for all point, for all intents and purposes. We can just forget about it. However, now there seems very good. There seems increasing, growing evidence that the cosmological constant is there and is not zero. So we have, in a serious discussion of gravity, we have dealing with. So let's start. We'll try to find the right the conventions for the sign. Just a minute.
Where are you using the details of the equilibration process?
It's not necessary. All that you require is that equilibration happens on length and time scales faster than the length and time scale of variation of approaches. Once that happens, there's one other place where we're in some sense of thing. You see, the next term in the derivative expansion, let's say the viscosity term, with so much symmetry, most of these terms are zero. But anyway, in principle, there are other terms in the derivative expansion of the stress tensor. Those, the magnitude of those other terms depend on the details of the equilibration process. For instance, viscosity is proportional to anything. Okay? And the fact that we're keeping these terms but neglecting the others is effectively the statement that mean free path is smaller than the length scales of variation of fields. You see, there would be another term which is effectively mean free path times derivative. We're neglecting that term. Because we're assuming that the mean free path is small compared to the mean free path divided by length scale of variation is a small. Okay, so that this expansion derivative is a good expansion. We assume that this equilibrium mechanism.
So expansion derivative is an expansion in the mean.
What? Is an expansion in the mean. Exactly. That's right. Okay, but that actually, though, with the kind of symmetry that we have, most terms that you could write down on the right hand, on the other side would be zero. Because there's a bulk viscosity that's not zero. Yeah, so there are terms that you could write down that would be non zero, and maybe not. Okay, fine. Okay, so please. So where are we? Yeah. So about the cosmological concept. So we wrote down Einstein's action. You know, when we started our discussion of Einstein's action, we wrote down square root g tetra plus some number which I will not bother with for now. Okay. But we discussed while writing this down that there's another term that one could have written down. You remember our logic for writing down this action was that if you did dimensional analysis, all the other terms, and you assume that the dimension full scale in the problem was Newton's constant, all the other terms were basically terms of 4 and 6 and up. So on derivatives were completely negligible. However, there was a term with 0 derivatives that seemed to dominate the Einstein action just by dimensional analysis. So if you assume that the coefficient of this has 2 derivatives, this has 0 derivatives. So you assume the coefficient of this is given, dimensional analysis is made up by Newton's constant here. This would be far dominant over this. It would invalidate flat space as a solution, even approximately, of Einstein's equations. And observationally, of course, that's not true. So lambda, if it's there, is very near to 0 on the scale of flat scale, on the scale of the mass associated with. Okay? But such terms allowed by the symmetries of our Lagrangian. And there seems no particular reason not to have it there. Now, Einstein originally wrote down his equation without this term, and he famously introduced such a term in order to try to have a static universe as a set of frequency equations. And then he famously withdrew this term in print, calling it his great, the greatest blunder he ever made, after Hubble discovered the universe was expanding. But you know, once science is not an issue of opinion even of great men, something is allowed by the equations, the safe policy is to put it there when you start solving equations and then you compare with experiment. Okay. So let's say that we start off with Einstein's equations based on such an action. Okay? Now, what are we going to get as our equations? So let's start varying this action. Okay? When we vary this action, we vary. So let's say S is equal to square root g, then g alpha theta r alpha theta r minus alpha plus 1. Now when we vary with respect to, let's vary the equation with respect to g alpha beta. Okay, when we vary with respect to g alpha beta alpha, from here we get r alpha beta. And from here we get minus r. Then what does it mean? So r plus lambda g alpha. There's of course also the variation within r, but that was a total derivative. Right? We went through that. So, Einstein's equations, if you write lambda this way, Einstein's equations are replaced by, instead of r alpha beta, minus half r g alpha beta, we get plus lambda g alpha beta is equal to, and then v by a. Okay, so this is the effect of modification of Einstein's equations led to by introducing this new term, the Lagrangian, this cosmology. Now, we could rework this as r alpha beta minus half r g alpha beta is equal to 8 by k g alpha beta plus half lambda g alpha beta. Okay? So we can absorb this part out into the matter stress tensor. If we associate the stress tensor t tilde alpha beta is equal to 1 by 16 by k g alpha beta to this cosmological term. Okay? So if you take t goes to t plus t tilde, okay, then Einstein's equations take their usual form. So you can think of Einstein's equations being modified only by imagining that there is a matter stress, this matter stress tensor of this form. Like in the side right, yes, with the plus. Okay, matter stress tensor of this form that permeates the universe. Okay. Effectively giving a stress tensor for that. Exactly. This is it sounds strange? Yeah. It's just the 0 point energy. You know, in a quantum field theory, the vacuum, quantum field theory can be thought of as a bunch of harmonic oscillators. The 0 point energy of all of these harmonic oscillators summed up could leave you with a residual 0 point energy for the vacuum. So it's not terribly strange. In fact, the thing that's really strange in quantum field theory language is why it's so small. Yeah, right. Okay, fine. you know, okay, maybe in some meta sense you think it's strange, then you have to, you know, explain the 80. It looks like it's there. Fine. Okay. Now, let's look at this this press tensor a little bit more before. Okay. So, this stress tensor here, please.
So that energy we take like from the material, that should be the energy of the matter.
Well, you could, if this harmonic oscillator applies also to the electrons. So it's the energy density of everything. But you see, the point is that it's there even in empty space. It's just a zero point energy.
That the energy of the field comes, that makes sense as a zero point energy of the electron.
And of the gravity.
So put it, this is the gravity.
Of everything. Whatever. You know, when you've got nothing running around, you've got no photon you can see, or graviton you can see, if there's still some residual energy density.
So where will it go? What will decide the residual?
In the vacuum.
Yeah, what has to decide something? You have to put a piece.
No. It's just the vacuum has a non-zero TP.
You have to consider the explanation for that thing.
Like that, there's no constitutive explanation. I mean, you know, it's that. What is constitutive? But I don't know. Okay, see. Yeah. Look, you could ask for a harmonic oscillator. What is the explanation for? Yeah, for harmonic oscillator, it doesn't seem important. There's the fact that it's just the uncertainty principle. And it's the energy of that stuff. So it's the energy of vibrations of the electrons. You see, let's say you've got a photon. Each mode of the photon is a harmonic oscillator. And so, if you accept the mode by mode, you understand where that comes from. This is just summing over all such things. Okay? But I have to say that, you know, it had long been expected that this would be zero. And it's really experiment that's driving us to seriously consider that it's not. Okay? There are many caveats here, some of which we'll explore. But, okay, fine. So, look, please.
Delta P delta, it's using an experiment. Cannot see the same thing in the fields, the uncertainty of fields.
What do you want to see using what do you see in the harmonic oscillator?
Using the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, you can observe the particles and see, observe that.
You could estimate, I was going to say, you could estimate the zero point energy from the Heisenberg.
So, you know, zero point energy exists because of the uncertainty of things.
Zero point energy must have.
Must
exist.
But can you say the same thing for fields?
Yeah, I think so.
Using an experiment.
You see, the thing is that even for harmonic oscillator, suppose somebody came and said, look, I don't believe there's zero point energy. The harmonic oscillator, energy of a harmonic oscillator starts at zero, and then you've got it right. Its next state is h power omega, next state is 2 h power omega. Show me an experiment that can convince me that this is not the case. There's nothing. Because only energy differences are measurable.
But in a sense, there is a spread.
That's right, that's the theory.
And you can measure the...
You can measure the spread, you can measure... But suppose he says, show me an experiment directly that measures that the energy is not zero. You can't. Okay? It's similar here, except that gravity couples to energy. It doesn't couple to energy differences. It couples to energy. Because of that, the zero point energy is measured. Due to the response of gravity to zero. Okay? So it's a subtle thing. It's a subtle thing. The only way we're seeing its effect is in how gravity couples to the stuff.
So one more thing.
Yes.
So when we do the wrong thing, now is it free compared to the energy distribution?
No. You see. It's proportional to the metric. The stress tensor is proportional to the metric. And eta is relative to the space.
let's say I am in some frame.
Yeah.
And I have to measure the energy density.
Yes.
The T alpha beta.
Yes.
Then I've got my G alpha beta also.
Yes.
Which means there's some.
Say you're in plasma. You measure G0. The point is that it's not only energy, there's also pressure. It's not only T0.
Yeah.
There's also TI. Eta alpha beta spread in there. You boost.
But now, I mean, how can I say? When I say it's eta alpha beta, my T alpha beta is already decided.
Well, the T alpha beta is proportional to the metric. If your metric at that point happens to be eta,
then my T alpha beta is also proportionally
eta. Proportional. Yes. But it's not frame dependent. You go to boosted frame, you get the same answer.
Accelerated.
You get a, I mean, this is the answer. T alpha beta is just whatever coordinate system you use, this is the answer. Okay, yes.
So do we have an absolute zero of energy in classical special relativity? For example, if we have a particle moving, then the expression for energy is E square equals to B square plus M square. Now if I were to redefine E by E equal to square root of B square plus M square plus a relative constant, then the four vector, then the combination E comma three vector B will perhaps not form a four vector.
Yes, you're right. But what you could do, you see, this, that's because you want the, what you're trying to do is to change the energy of a particle compared to its not being there.
Yeah.
That is in the end also an energy difference. Imagine the particle. Imagine it not being there. That's completely well defined. But suppose you try to change the energy of the vacuum of space.
Yeah.
There's nothing that can distinguish that. You see, anytime you could imagine an experiment in which you take an energy difference, that's always enough.
Yeah.
But there's always going to be one ambiguity. Because the energy of there being nothing is completely arbitrary. On top of that, you start at some arbitrary zero and then you build it.
Yeah.
But that arbitrary zero will always be arbitrary. Okay? In general relativity, that arbitrariness is also missed. Because curvature of space-time reacts to the energy density, not to some difference. That's some absolute notion of energy density that sits on the right hand side of Einstein's equations. Okay? Now, so just to go back here, this lambda could have either a positive or a negative sign. Okay? Now, the way we've written it, I should have put it up there. T alpha beta is equal to G alpha beta times 16 pi k. Now, there's the following, we use the following terminology. Okay. The lambda with which gives rise to a stress tensor with positive pressure. So that's the thing that would cause acceleration. It's called a positive constant. Okay? Lambda, which gives rise to a stress tensor with negative pressure, pulls things, causes deceleration of the universe, called negative constant. Okay? Now it's important to note that it's the pressure that determines whether this thing is positive or negative. Because the pressure and the energy density have opposite signs. Okay? So the positive cosmological constant comes with a negative energy density. And the negative cosmological constant comes with a positive energy density. Okay? So such a term is a possibility in Einstein's equations. It's called a cosmological constant, could come with either sign. And Einstein had to introduce this term because he realized that a positive cosmological constant could lead to positive pressure,
that could balance the pull of gravity and lead to a static universe. Okay. Something he didn't realize at that time was the static universe is unstable. So couldn't really describe the universe. And since then we've seen that the universe is not static, so that's not a good motivation for introducing this term. But the good motivation for introducing this term is that it's possible, it's there, consistent with all the principles of our theory. So maybe it exists. Okay? And so this one, then. So there are three effective forms of matter of stress tensor that we've discussed. The stress tensor that comes from cosmological constant, the stress tensor that comes from dust, the galaxy, the stress tensor that comes from photons. Okay? And in the right, on the right hand side of Einstein's equations, you could imagine all three contribute. And we'll allow such a possibility. Yes. Some here.
So even like the R alpha beta term, that could be also defined in some sort of like absorbing the energy necessary to get us in order of energy.
I mean, in the end, it's a matter of words.
So, and why do you like lambda has to be associated with vacuum energy? That's not something to do with those
two. You know, in the end, it's a matter of words. What we're doing is solving an equation.
What source is it?
In terms of understanding the curvature,
you know, if there is an equation with a term constant times g alpha beta, you might want to think of it as the energy of the vacuum, because I agree with you. It's basically a matter of words. But suppose vacuum did have an energy density, then it would give rise to such a term. Okay. Basically what you want in the end is a theory of this term. You want your fundamental theory of particle physics to predict the right equation with the right value of lambda.
Is there any definition apart from
vacuum? Well, we don't even know for sure, for instance, that there is such a term. Well, because you know what we know is that there's an acceleration of the universe. But there are many other effects that can cause such a thing. No, I don't think. You see, again, the energy of the vacuum is not terribly. What's really important is this. What's important is the one-point function of the vacuum. What this is a source for in the vacuum. Do you see what I mean? So your theory, whatever it is, should predict that in the vacuum there is a one-point function for the vacuum. This is not quite the vacuum. And if you assume that they function. Okay? And that's the calculation of that is essentially the same as the calculation of the vacuum energy. When you take this one-point function of k equals 0, omega equals 0, it's essentially the calculation of the vacuum. So the same calculation you would do to calculate this thing is the calculation you would do to the vacuum energy. But in the end, you're completely right. You know, many people don't need to give these words to this term. What we want to do is to get the right equation for gravity. And somehow or the other, we have to get it. Okay? It seems like there is such a term in the correct equation for the universe. And the outstanding puzzle, the question is how do you produce such a term? Starting from a more fundamental theory. Okay? The rest is a bit of a okay, we're almost out of time, but let me just continue. Okay, so now we understand what kinds of terms we're going to be willing to put on the right hand side of Einstein's equations. Okay? Now, with this understanding in place, we want to go ahead and solve Einstein's equations. Okay. So, firstly, this stuff has been abstract. What value of u mu and u nu are we going to give? Are we going to give the matter fields? Well, it's pretty clear, right? If these things have to have the symmetries of the problem, they have to be addressed. Because otherwise, there would be a vector field, namely the velocity vector field, in spatial directions, which would break the symmetries of the problem. So in our problem, what we're going to do is to set u0 as the only non-zero guy. And then u0 squared will have to be equal to 1. So u0, so in our problem, what we're going to do note that for the cosmological constant, E plus P is 0. Because E coefficient of G 0, 0 is minus coefficient of G I I, which is P. So what you said for U is irrelevant. Of course, because there's nothing really in the P. So what we're going to do is set U 0. U 0, sorry, P is 0, 0 equals. Now this this term would have to be such that we want now in our sign convention what is it? U nu G mu nu is it 1 or minus 1? Is plus 1. Because the time part is 1. The time part is 1. Okay, fine. So what we're going to have then is that u0 u0 will be equal to g0, 0. So that when you multiply with g0, 0 up against 1. Okay? Yes. And so T00 will be equal to epsilon times G00. Zero zero. PII will be equal to P times minus P times GII. And TI0 DIJ. Okay? So, now with some understood equation of state relating epsilon and p. So by the way, what's the equation of state for cosmological constant? The equation of state is a u0 constant, or p0 constant. Okay, with cosmological constant. Fine. So, with some understanding of what this equation of state is, we're going to now plug this equation into Einstein's equations. And compute what we need. We'll have to do that next class. So in the next class we'll find the equations for motion of cosmology, equations that will determine both epsilon as a function of time, as well as A as a function of time in cosmology, and then we'll start trying to interpret the expressions. Okay. Oh, yes, what have we decided? We decided one extra class, right? Do you remember what day? What? Tuesday, and was it the afternoon? What is free for you? Tuesday afternoon. Okay. So Tuesday, so tomorrow?
Yeah.
We'll try. In fact, we found that tomorrow.